top of the morning. Start fresh. You know, I won't say that I struggled, but that's kind of what it is. I'm kind of struggling whether or not I should make a video like this. But if you clicked on it, you're probably interested in what I have to say, so here we go. I'm back home in, I'm actually in Southern Ohio right now, Portsmouth, Ohio, at a hotel. Dad's in the hospital again. Mom and I are fixing to go to the hospital and probably be in a pull the plug situation. And what to even say, because I understand that there's boundaries and I don't want to preach at anyone, but sometimes people need to hear stuff. And in case there's somebody out there that needs to hear this, I hope that you get my message. So let's talk a little bit about alcoholism. My dad is not dying of old age. He's dying because for 40 years or more, probably, yeah, 50 to 55 years, he has abused alcohol. And none of us are born alcoholics. Very few people are so triggered by it to where as soon as they drink it, they become an alcoholic. Most of us have to work really hard at becoming an alcoholic. And we don't hear that enough. We don't hear that enough. We just hear either you're an alcoholic or you're not an alcoholic. But if you're drinking every day, you're probably an alcoholic. It's just the reality of it. You may think that you're not because, well, I still get up and I go to work and it doesn't affect my life and blah, 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 blah. Or you might go, well, I skip a day every now and then. It's not a big deal. Well, what happens is, you know, the six pack at night over the years becomes a 12 pack at night. And then the 12 pack at night becomes a high alcohol content 12 pack at night or becomes an 18 pack a night. And eventually it gets to the point to where you're drinking 30 a day. And the only way to stop that is keep yourself in check. There is no way to stop that and still keep drinking. Okay. If you continue to drink, you will become an alcoholic. And so right now my father's organs are shutting down on him. And this started about 6 years ago, 7 years ago, 8 years ago, really started actually degrading his body rapidly. And he wouldn't stop. Even after some serious problems, you know, he still continued to do it. And that's because he didn't try to stop 30 years previously. So if you've been drinking for 30 years and think that everything's going to be fine, yeah, you're out of your mind. It's not going to work out that way. Man, I had so many things to say. But now that it's time to say it, I forget everything. But I grew up dirt poor. I mean, just poor. And that's why if you're a longtime viewer of the channel, it's really hilarious to me. There was a guy, it's been a couple guys actually, But there was one guy specifically that claimed that we didn't all come from generational wealth. We don't have it as easy as you do. Oh, you motherfucker. Me come from generational wealth. My whole childhood, the water that we got to take a shower in to flush our toilets was siphoned directly from a pond. We would bathe in pond water. And there was no filter on it. We just, that's the way we lived our life. And I had to check that hose every year, right? At least once a year. It was a long one too. I had to, we lived in Kentucky, so hills are abundant. We lived at the bottom of a hill in a valley. My grandfather lived on the top of the hill, and he had a pond. It was just mud. It was mud. You know the pond you look at, it's a brown, muddy pond. That's what it was. We siphoned from that up at the top of the hill all the way down to our house, and it was probably about 300 yards, right? And so I had to run down holding that hose. And whenever my hand got wet, I would stop and I would go back and I would do a patchwork on that because it was that black pipe that you get for cheap, and just laid on top of the ground. And it would just spring leaks and I had to fix them. It was one of my many chores. And my dad drank every single day of his life that I remember. There were many times where he put me in a situation that I should not have been in, so that he could continue his drinking and go to a bar in town over in Portsmouth. One time specifically, I can remember, he brought me, I was my mother's attempt at an anchor to my father. I was the youngest of four children, and my mother said to my dad, "Well, if you're going to go, you've got to bring Jason Bodie with you," because she thought that that would keep his drinking in check and that he would not go too far because he knew he had me that he had to take care of. Well, that didn't always work. And I can remember we were at this man's house. Everybody called him Bulldog. Paul Hamilton was his name. And he was a genuinely nice old man that just, drank whiskey 24/7 and listened to Jimmy Buffett, And don't worry, this story's not going to go in a weird direction. Nothing bad happened. But yeah, somebody else came over. Dad wanted to continue the drinking. He wants to go over into town, go to a bar. And he leaves me there with Bulldog at Bulldog's house. And he charges another man with taking care of me. I don't remember this guy's name. I think his last name was Craycraft. Anyways, all I can remember is he had great big arms. Big, I was probably 9 years old, something like that. And my dad was a big fighter, right? He would get into bar fights. This was his, for whatever insecurities he may have had, that was his way of saying, "No, I'm a tough guy." He would fight at the drop of a hat. And as a grown up, as a child, I saw that, well, my dad's a badass, you don't mess with him. But as a grown up, I look back on it, I was like, what kind of insecurities was he working with to where he needed to get into physical altercations with men all the time to prove himself? That is classic insecure behavior. And but he told this man, this Craycraft man, take care of my son, What that led up to is at about 2 o'clock in the morning, whenever he still wasn't back to get me, this Craycraft man forces me, because he was ready to pass out. he was done. He was drunk as could be, probably 20 or 30 beers in him. He was pass out drunk. And but he wanted to make sure that I didn't get into something I shouldn't get into. And so he forced me to get on the couch and he spooned with me. And he put that big arm, I can still remember that big arm wrapping around me. And he's like, "You're Larry Pennington's son. I am gonna take care of you. Ain't nothing gonna happen to you on my watch." 'Cause A, he was genuinely a good person. He really was. But B, if something happened to me, my dad would beat the shit out of him. And so here I am, 8, 9, 10 years old, being spooned by this strange drunk man on a couch, forced, and he had me. I wasn't getting out of that, And he passes out, Once he's clearly passed out, I got away from him and, just sat in the corner or something like that. If you think that you might have a drinking problem, then you have a drinking problem. And the only way to get a handle on that is to not drink. And a lot of people try and fool themselves and go, "Well, I'll just go down. I'll be a three beer kind of guy. I'll never go past that." Well, that's the thing with alcohol. Once you start it, you want more. And I feel really, really happy that I can say that it's been about a year and a half for me since I realized, you know what? I might have a drinking problem. And so, actually, I knew I had a drinking problem. I was uncertain whether or not I was an alcoholic, but I knew that I had a drinking problem. And whenever you have a problem, the people you love the most are the people who get hurt the most. And like the way I see it, my father loved alcohol more than any of his children or his wife, because we all begged him to stop drinking. And that's kind of a cop out. It's not that easy once you're actually an alcoholic, and I understand that, But we asked whenever he was young, in his 30s, and he could have stopped drinking then. Could he stop whenever he was in his 60s? No, he tried and he couldn't do it. But for you guys out there that still can stop, and you all can stop, you all can, it's just a matter of willpower. But I'm telling you, you need to stop. If you think you have a problem, it's clear you do have a problem. And we all play games and we justify this and that. I think the biggest thing that scared me about not drinking anymore, the number one thing that scared me about not drinking, is I thought my life would change so much. I thought I would never be able to hang out with my friends anymore. What does life look like if I'm not drinking a six-pack every night? What does my life look like? It's boring, right? Well, that's completely untrue. That is it's just so false. Just so far from false. And you don't know that until you go through it, I thought that I would be at a get together with my friends and be jonesing for a beer and not be able to control myself and have to leave. No, not at all. Not at all. I don't have any problem with somebody else drinking. It doesn't bother me, not at all. And the only thing that has changed is whenever they start getting belligerent and stupid, I leave, That's really it. And it takes a long time for that to happen. I mean, seriously, most grown men can really drink six beers before they start really getting kind of stupid, and that takes a long time to drink six beers, even for a really hardcore drinker, that's a couple hours, but most people, that's more like 3, sometimes 4 hours, before they get to that point to where they're like, kind of, you're kind of stupid, and I'm leaving. So that's still a long time that you get to enjoy with your people. So if you're thinking of that and you're wondering, how would my life look if I don't drink? It's going to look exactly the same as it did. The only thing that's going to be different is you are going to see things that you didn't see before. You are going to smell things that you go, oh God, I had no idea I smelled like that whenever I got drunk. So if that's what's holding you back, have no fear. No fear whatsoever. It's perfectly fine. It's been like a steady like year and a half, 18 months or more since I touched alcohol, and it's just not even a thing. The closest I ever got to any kind of withdrawal type of stuff was early on, everything would be just fine, but then when I would be grocery shopping, as I passed that aisle at Kroger or whatever, I would get nervous. But that's it, I would be like, I would just feel it. I wouldn't be drawn to go down there and buy some alcohol. I would just get nervous and weird, But that's it, I did a couple AA meetings. Actually, I did probably 7 or 8. But I'm looking around, and I must emphasize this. I got very, very lucky in getting out of it before it had its claws in me. Because at this point, I can look back on it and go, no, I was not an alcoholic. I just had a drinking problem. I drank too much. And so whenever I was at those alcoholic meetings, I'm looking around at everybody, and they're telling stories that are off the charts crazy. Well, like the story that I just told of my dad leaving me with that guy, and I'm a little kid and I'm being spooned by this old drunk man. But there were several situations like that. And when dad finally did come get me at 3 or 4 in the morning, and we're driving home, and he's clearing out every ditch along the way. Here I am, a little kid, telling dad, hey, I can drive, dad. You better let me drive. Oh, I got it. I got it. But at this point, the whole losing my father thing, yeah, it hurts. But more than that, I'm mad. I'm mad because his body is failing him, and he won't face up to that. And so he is what they call a full code, meaning he told the doctors, if you can save me, save me. And so the healthcare staff have to do everything in their power to save his life. His heart stops. They're going to try and revive him, And he has been in that situation now probably seriously 4 or 5 times. And all of the life-saving measures that they're taking over the past like 6 or 7 years have been in the millions of dollars. Who's paying for that? Well, my mom and dad are poor, so they're not paying for it. The government taxpayers paying for it. And the life that he keeps coming back to is just hell. My mom has to clean his shit, clean his puke. So if you ever get to that situation, set up a DNR, which is called a do not resuscitate. So if you believe in heaven and hell, then whenever you die, go to one of them, you know? Don't come back to this life because it's no life. Don't kid yourself. If you've smoked for 40 or 50 years and you're like, oh no, I'm gonna beat this cancer. Bullshit. No, you are not. Your body is wrecked and it is time to say goodbye to this world. All right? No judgment. Just saying, whenever you're bad enough to where that problem that you had is killing you, accept it and go. Because it makes life for your loved ones hell. And alcoholism, any kind of addiction, is a very selfish thing. And the only thing I can do at this point is look at it and be pissed at my dad for still being so selfish. He was selfish all his life. We never had two nickels to rub together, yet he still managed to buy himself his alcohol all my life. His family did without so that he could have his enjoyment. And that's wrong. That is selfish. But let's say you got a good job and you make good money and you didn't have that. Your family didn't do without. Well, you're still selfish in the end because they're having to suffer through this 20 years too early, long, brutal process of death because you are continually hanging on. Cruel? Maybe. But I don't see it that way because I know how I feel about my father. I love my father. I idolized him for a good 25 years of my life, as every child with a father does. You know, we all do that. Maybe. But yeah. So, tonight is the winner of the chainsaw, the Makita. And I'll try and get to it and do that video. But if I don't, you know what's going on. And I know you guys are very understanding and stuff. And I've heard, you know, like Buchan did a video somehow just kind of hinting at his past or whatever. And that's fine and dandy and great and everything. Well, I'm not the kind of person to hint. All right? I don't usually drop hints. I tell you point blank what the fuck is going on. And right now, this is what I'm dealing with. And I'm hoping that my brash version of the truth will make a difference to somebody out there, you know? Any of your addictions, of course they're hurting you. Of course they are. But in the end, and sometimes during, the people that you're hurting the most isn't you. It's your loved ones. So if you need a reason to stop, well, the reason is the people that you love in your life. Okay? And if you are fearful of how your life will look without that addiction that you enjoy so much, it is better by far. You know, and I kind of, you know, I wasn't an alcoholic. I just basically drank a six pack a night. And then, you know, that would change to sometimes it would be a six pack of tall boys, right? You know, like Miller Lite, Bud Light, whatever. Which is not, I mean, why do people care that they put a transgender person on a can of beer? That's beyond me why people give a shit what other people do in their bedroom. It's just completely, I don't have a clue. I can't understand that. But anyways, that's a little off topic. But you know, so I didn't have a real hardcore problem. But it was enough to where I said, you know, this is going to get out of hand. And I got out early, and I'm very thankful for that. And since then, everything in my life is better. I have more money. Because, shoot, between my wife and myself, sure, we probably spent $600 a month on alcohol. Probably, you know? And now we don't. That's more chainsaws. And so we got more money. We feel better. Feel healthier. I'll even go so far to say sex is better. Sex is better because it just is. You know, you're not plowing away, just waiting for the finish, and then pass out. You know, so everything is better. And the only issue that I've had with my friends is they are more uncomfortable than I am. Because in me being like, no, I'm Coca-Cola is fine with me, they then feel guilty and like, oh my God, is he passing judgment on me? No, I'm not passing judgment on you. You do whatever you want, right? But they seem to have a very, at first, they had a problem with me not drinking because they internalized that as how does he see me? And oh, my friends are still my friends, and you know, it's fine, and I don't talk with them and say, you know, you need to stop this. And I'm not saying that to any of you guys. You know, I'm just saying this is what it looks like on your loved one's end. And also, if you are considering it, it's nothing but good. I mean, I don't know. Have you ever known somebody who recovered from some sort of addiction and was like, damn it, I wish I'd never done that? No, everybody that recovers from any kind of addiction is very happy that they did it. So and clearly, it is better on this side. You know, life is better whenever you don't have that thorn in your side, whenever you don't have to, you know, get out of the house at 8 p.m. My place, I've got a gas station really close by. So the distance isn't a big deal, but getting out, getting in the car, driving to my gate, unlocking the gate, going through the gate and down to the gas station to get a beer, and then come back, relock the gate, get back in house and continue drinking. That is a chore that I no longer have to do because I don't need to continue drinking. I don't need to drink, period. You know? So anyways, from the most simple and mundane thing that you no longer have to do, life is better when you aren't tied to some rock. So anyways, that's where I'm at right now. Here, and I gotta hop in the shower. It's first thing in the morning, and I wanted to grab a cup of coffee. But yeah, we're gonna go up to the hospital and hopefully say our goodbyes. He's in kidney and liver failure. He's on a ventilator, and hopefully it'll be a situation to where we can say, okay, have the morphine ready. Give him a shot of that and say our goodbyes. And because, man, if he comes back again from this, he's just living in shit, literally. And he can't see it because it's our number one human instinct. Number one, the most basic human instinct that we have is to survive. And a young person like me that's in good health can't really understand that because I see them through my eyes. I can't see them through their eyes. And everyone that's in that situation, I'm like, what don't you get? You can't get out of bed to go take a shit. Why are you wanting to hang on to this life? But we all do it, and I'll probably do it whenever I get older, you know? But yeah, I don't know if this video is going to make a difference to anybody. I hope it does. I hope it does. And I wish the best for everyone, you know? Even the people that don't like me, it's a prick to me. You know? I want everybody to do well. But yeah, addiction is a bitch. And the sooner you can get out of it, the sooner your life will get better.